really wanted to kind of set out your story to start with, if you like. And I mean, within that, tell us, where does the fight go now? Well, I just wanted to start with a couple of observations really. I don't think I've ever seen such a divisive time in politics or such a divided country, at least in my political lifetime. But I don't think it's as simple as Remain versus Leave. My sense is that there's a substantial number of people who voted Leave who have intense opposition that this is the best ever thing for Britain. Equally, there is a significant number of Remainers who think it's a complete disaster. But in between, there are people who did vote Leave, but we just have to get on with it. And there are people who voted Leave but who are still anxious about what lies ahead. And for all of Theresa May's talk about uniting the country, she has done precisely too. A key part of her entire focus, I think, has been on convincing the hardline expertise within her own party and the media that she stands for them, whereas she should have been trying to bring the country together. It is a difficult issue for Labour. I think we had the top 10 Remain voting constituencies and the top 10 Leave voting constituencies within our party. And I think the task force now is not to cave in to the billion of some of the hardline expertise to provide some honesty and realism in the public debate about the difficult decisions and products that will inevitably require as we try and strike a deal. But to do this in a way that makes us not simply predictive of doom and gloom. It is worth remembering that Labour did this in the past, and let's remember we've only won four elections since the Second World War, have always held together so-called traditional working class voters in post-industrial heartlands with our more socially liberal supporters in metropolitan cities. And crucially, we have had a hopeful and optimistic message about the future that everybody feels part of. And I think that means recognising that the battle for the future isn't so much about rewinning the referendum or refighting the Remain versus Leave. The real battle about Britain's future is whether we want to be an open or closed society. Whether we believe we should be isolationist in trying to go it alone, or internationalist working with others. It's about whether we want a union Brexit that actually focuses on jobs and growth and opportunities for young people. Firstly, what I see as the more extremist major of Brexiteers who do have a vision of a first state, deregulated, simple thing vision for the country, which is not what is right for Britain and is not what anyone voted for. And I think the real people that we have to defeat in the years ahead is not what leaves the moral issue, it is fighting the nationalists and the nostalgists. And we have a British Nationalist Party that says they want to remain part of the European Union for jobs, prosperity and security, yet rejects the very union on its own doorstep that has delivered precisely this for hundreds of years. And we have the oldest nationalists and hard no-deal Brexiteers. There's a quick comes to share with both of that no-deal election, which would be the worst outcome for Britain. And to see more focus on reclaiming a musical past than an optimistic vision for Britain in the future. That is a challenge for Labour, but I think it's where we must go if we want to bring the country together and have a chance of winning the election in 2020. Thank you, Emma. So the fight's certainly good there, and I've got to go on with both of you. So, Stephen.
Thanks very much. Somebody was talking about earlier on how we haven't had much experience of referendum in the UK. Well, we've got a little bit more experience, and I know that also in the UK they've got slightly, but even more now. I think it's worthwhile just in terms of the background for me just to start out. I know a lot of people know this, but just in terms of where we're coming from, that obviously the United Kingdom is made up of seven nations who are in a who are in a union together. One of those sovereign nations, Scotland, voted overwhelmingly 24-point gap to remain part of the European Union. I think that that's a good midnight referendum in pretty much any member state of the European Union. Most of me has grabbed that 62% with both hands. It was a fairly, significant result, and it was a good result as well. We're now moving into the territory of how do we move on from that. Obviously, our referendum and the aftermath has been covered by the fact that in the independence referendum in 2014, we were told that the only way for Scotland to maintain its EU membership was to vote against independence. That's clearly not the case. We also received the promises during the European referendum of getting powers over things like immigration, which is something that doesn't look like we're going to get either. Why this is important is this is where we take ourselves in terms of our next step. One thing that happened, the most expansive document that came out before Article 50 was triggered, was when the Scottish Government produced a compromise document. And that compromise said that we will accept the referendum result, even though that takes Scotland out of the EU against its will. That was quite a big deal, actually. So that's something that given where our politics is, I think it was something that was missed. That was quite a big deal for the First Minister to have offered that concession. In return, we wanted to see membership of the single market, maintenance of freedom of movement, and the right to remain free EU nationals. They were three big asks, and those documents, those asks are contained within the Scottish Government compromise document that came out just before Christmas. That compromise was rejected. So having that compromise rejected, we think our next step is to put the question of independence. It's an entirely new situation now, so we think there should be an independence referendum in Scotland with the aim of Scotland maintaining its membership of the European Union. The idea behind that and the timetable for that is not now. The timetable that we've asked for has been sort of autumn 2018 to spring 2019, which is, as Michel Barnier has acknowledged and others have acknowledged, is when the UK will need to sort out some kind of deal anyway. So it's to give people a choice once we know what leave actually looks like. So I think that's quite important. I agree with Liz on a large number of things that she mentioned.
That's not the end.
I think it's unfair to compare the European Union with the Treaty of Union. I mean, the European Union is a union of 28 independent sovereign member states who can make their own decisions. The Treaty of Union isn't. It's one where one of the, if you want to call it member states, one of the states can be overridden frequently, but as a voluntary union, that's something that we concede. So the question that we want to put is, does the Treaty of Union survive Brexit? And that's not something that we want to decide, it's something we want to give the people the choice to decide. Until that happens, we have negotiations. I mean, we are looking at a Herculean bureaucratic task, but given the debate we had during the EU referendum, then looks like we're going to get more bureaucrats, not less bureaucrats, as a result of the referendum results. And as the third biggest party at Westminster, we have a responsibility to play a role, as we have been all along. I've been an MP for about 2 minutes when I had to take the EU referendum bill through Parliament on behalf of my party. But we will be playing again. We want to play a constructive task in that to represent the needs and requirements of our constituents. One thing that I always say to people is that this is such a big task that if anybody's here, if you're representing groups who are interested in the environment, human rights, various industries, stakeholders, people need to start shouting loudly now because this is such a massive task that there will be prioritised industries, unfortunately. We've seen that already. And we need people to start shouting about their particular interests. There's a policy vacuum in Westminster at the moment, and so we all have a responsibility to try and fill that. I agree with Liz, just to come back, I will agree with Liz on the devastating impact of no deal. I'm a member of the Foreign Affairs Committee. We have a majority who are Brexiteer Tories on my committee. We produced a report saying that if there is no deal, it will have much worse an impact for the United Kingdom than it will for the rest of the European Union, although it's not good for anybody. And finally, just as a small correction, but I want you to understand where we are coming from. I'm not the Brexit spokesperson, I'm the Europe spokesperson. I always find that that's quite a useful way to sort that out as well.
Okay. My apologies, you can tell us about all those other non-Brexit issues that we're talking about with links to Europe too. Douglas, a Herculean bureaucratic task. Is that what you've brought upon us?
The business of self-government does require quite a lot of effort and energy, and I'll elaborate on quite how much effort and energy I think it will take. But taking control of your destiny, I would say, is on balance worth it, and I hope we can agree on that at many levels. If I could just begin very broadly, Brexit is very often bracketed with the election of Donald Trump to the White House, or the rise of hit builders, or Man in the Pan. I want to suggest a different analysis, which is that perhaps Brexit is a safety valve. Donald Trump or Hit Builders are what you end up with if you don't have the safety valve, if the priorities of the public aren't recalibrated with those who actually make public policy. I very much agree with what Liz talks about when she says we need Britain to be an open society, we need it to be an internationalist society. And it's precisely because I'm very much a liberal in the perhaps somewhat old-fashioned sense of the term, that I very much support the idea that a self-governing people should make its own public policy priorities, and those who make public policy should be vulnerable to the views of the public. I think it's a very good thing, and I think it's actually a very liberalising thing. Now, we know that Brexit is going to happen insofar as by April 2019, European laws, EU courts, and EU legislatures will no longer have jurisdiction in the United Kingdom. But I think it's fairly obvious to say that much else about our relationship with our allies and neighbours is still to be decided. I'm very keen that we should have what I call not a hard Brexit or a soft Brexit, but a liberal Brexit. What do I mean by that? Well, quite often people who were hostile to the idea of us voting to leave are keen to point out supposedly insurmountable obstacles, which apparently make the business of self-government all too difficult for us to worry about. But I just think some of these insurmountable obstacles are nothing of the kind. So perhaps I'm optimistic that we're going to get a good deal, for the very reason that Theresa May is prepared, if necessary, to not sign up to any deal. She saw what happened to David Cameron. David Cameron put himself in a most extraordinary position where he said he had to stay in and strike a deal at almost any price. And sure enough, he got a rather bad deal. I think Theresa May has seen that up close, and I think takes the view for both the philosophical and pragmatic reasons that she's prepared to walk away if we don't get a good deal. And for that very reason, I suspect we will get rather a good one. Sometimes people talk about the issue of migration as though that is an insurmountable obstacle, and it's true. By April 2019, if not sometime before, the free movement of people will come to an end. But that doesn't mean we can't have the free movement of workers. If we hadn't been a member of the EU this past 44 unhappy-something years, it's inconceivable that a British company or university or hospital think tank wouldn't be able to hire EU workers. I envisage that we will end up with a scenario where British employers are free to hire nationals from EU member states, probably with one major proviso, which is that they pay them a sufficiently large sum of money in their salary package to preclude the possibility of them claiming in-work benefits. It's actually, when you start to think of it in those terms, as some of us have spent 20 years thinking about it, it's actually relatively straightforward. Whilst employers are doing goods and services is impossible, and you know, if necessary, we would move to WTO, and I wouldn't prefer that, but it's perfectly manageable. WTO rules were after all introduced to allow trade and exchange and to prevent isolationism and protectionism. And if we had a deal on Brexit, it would be dealing with one entity, the EU, if we were talking about services, it would be with 27, but I suspect it's possible to actually bundle a treaty on both of those aspects of trade policy together. And what really struck me about the response of the EU was not the inclusion of reference to Gibraltar, which was predictable and inevitable and of little consequence, but the fact that actually almost everything else in that formal response could have been written by HMG. There was an insistence that, yes, we have no land with islands, that we reach our deal on citizens, EU citizens and UK citizens, based on reciprocity and mutual respect pretty quickly. Then there's all the right sounds about trade policy. And then, critically, they even said that, in the, I think you have to word there, that no deal is decided until everything is decided. So it's so much for that idea that we were going to have to settle the Brexit deal before we could talk about trade. On the contrary, there's goodwill and pragmatism, and I think that came across very strongly, despite everyone's obsession with the issue of Gibraltar. Some people say that, you know, if we do this, it's going to be hideously complex. And sure, if you've been a member of parliament for many years and you've not bothered to get your head around public policy made under the auspices of the EU treaties on things like data protection, and you suddenly have to familiarise with yourself with it, and you suddenly realise that all these aspects of public policy were being made, well, you may have to start doing your job as a member of the legislature and start being accountable to people for the state's monopoly on the creation of law and raising of taxation. But, you know, if you're in Westminster, you really think that the issue of Western public policy is so hideously complicated that you can't bear it, you know, other people will quite cheerfully take your job in the 2019 general election. A couple of closing remarks if I may. I've been talking to a lot of 50 or 100 companies over the past couple of months, and I've been very struck by quite how pragmatic and positive many of them are. I think many of them relied on the person on the boardroom table who was in charge of corporate affairs to explain what Brexit was all about. They were inevitably told that it would be hideous and horrible. Those who've got skin in the game in Brussels generally think that. I think they now realise that actually it's nothing of the kind that they were expecting. A key to recognising, to understanding our relations with the EU going forward will be the phrase mutual standard recognition. I now see City UK and others are abandoning the phrase about all around us. It was their idea, wonderful. New ideas go from people saying it's unthinkable to it's impractical to saying it was their idea all along, and if people want to claim these ideas as their own, fantastic. To quote the proverb, I think this is absolutely right. The last thing we should be prepared to put up with is a government or a faction within a government or a faction on the backbenches of the Tory party or indeed my party, imposing its vision of public policy. The whole point is that if you want to change things, the great proverb must become the great transfer. It must not be changed by stealth. If you want higher environmental regulations, and I hope the Green Party pushes for that, or higher social protection, I hope the Labour Party, which wants you to stand for organised labour, goes for that, then put it in your manifesto and get a mandate for it. Don't change it by stealth in the meantime. And then we've got consensus. It's absolutely vital we have consensus. And I've been quite struck by the conservatory tones. Not all of those who are on the lead side, but those who are associated with the official Vote New campaign have been very, very conciliatory. But please don't make the mistake of thinking that many of the forces in British politics that achieved the result the Vote Leave are nostalgic. If your perception is truly a nostalgic phenomenon, looking at a colour of people's passports, for goodness sake, it probably would have fizzled out in mid-1990-something. I think many of the forces that underlie the change of Brexit are not going to go away. They're going to become more pronounced. And I think one day people, I hope on the left, will discover they're actually pretty exhilarating and progressive and liberating. Thank you.
Okay, thank you all for your comments. Well, I'm going to ask a few questions, and I'm going to start with the great repeal, then I'm going to go straight back to you, Douglas. You talked about Labour putting into its manifesto social policy protections, the Greens putting into their manifesto environmental protections. What would you put into your manifesto as to what would happen to those regulations after a future general election?
I did think of Europe long before I ever joined a political party, and I think if you take a long-term historic view, as a society, any society, people are all fundamentally the same. As they get richer and wealthier, the first thing they do is spend more money on education. You see that in every society. Second thing they spend more money on is health. Health and education have been rising for a good reason. The third thing I think we're beginning to discover is as people get wealthier, they want to put money into preserving their environment.
And I think one of the great tragedies of EU membership is that often minimum standards have become the maximum standards. And I think there are an awful lot of things we can do. I'm not just talking about making sure that we have an agricultural policy that actually conserves the countryside a little better than it does, rather than just allowing people to farm subsidies. I look at some of the ideas of people like George Monbiot, not a natural bedfellow of mine, about rewilding. I'm inspired by the idea that we could actually spend a higher percentage of our GDP, and yes, use state intervention if necessary, to raise environmental standards. I think it's a very exciting idea, and I think that anyone in the Green Party who's not thinking in these terms is missing a trick.
So you will have more regulation?
Oh, for environmental protection, that's
good. For working out water rights?
As we get wealthier, I think the idea of people having longer leave and longer break and maternity break will become an established norm. And we need to be a little bit careful about making promises with other people's balance sheets. But I certainly don't want to reduce worker rights. And I suspect my children will live in a world where workers have higher standards of protection. I think that will be a good thing.
Okay. Some people might think not your party, but the Conservative Party voted against the Equality Act not long ago. Some people like Carol Hahn and your colleague would say that actually over the decades, Europe was power to our elbow in terms of getting some of these rights through, and that actually the vision that Douglas is presenting was actually a very hard, thoughtful vision. Do you worry that perhaps some people don't agree with Douglas that there should be an increase in protections? We saw during the debate in the Commons when the so-called Great Repeal Bill was announced. I just think all of these terms are supposed to be a transfer of laws here. I fear that actually we will see them cut. We saw quite a few Conservative backbenchers during that debate saying precisely that the reason we left Europe was to cut regulations, and whether that's workers' rights or environmental standards. And I don't doubt Douglas's conviction on the point he says, but the truth is that is not what drove the people leading the Leave campaign. And I am afraid, Douglas, he's sort of rewriting history to try and say that is what won it. People like you, who are independently minded, got into bed with precisely the people who do want a closed society, a deregulated state vision of the country for the future. And my concern about where Theresa May has been is that she has pandered to those forces. She didn't have to work on and seek to reach out to Remain as well as Leave voters. And my view in politics is if you pander to those in the extremes, whether that's the right or the left, they are never satisfied. They take and take and take and never accept compromise. So I am concerned that what we will really see, especially if we don't have parliamentary safeguards, is a reduction of those rights and standards. And the truth is, one of the main reasons for Brexit, there were many different, you voted, I know for different reasons, I believe, for many of my constituents or people across the East Midlands. They were more concerned about immigration. They were fed up about their pay packets not being an increase. They were worried about housing, about schools. And my worry is, building the hardline liberal Brexiteers aren't going to make those issues any better. In fact, they're likely to make them worse. Okay. Stephen, just asking if you go on and want to look at the deal, but I was going to put to you another thing. Yeah. You said that you have to threaten no deal if you want to get a good deal. I mean, do you think that that is true?
No, I don't. And actually, one thing that struck me since the start of this was actually just after the referendum, the EU referendum, I was struck by the lack of a conciliatory tone from the Prime Minister. I have to say that I expected, or would have expected, the first thing the Prime Minister would have done would have been to go to Brussels, say, look, we're out, but to reassure that this remains our most important relationship, because whether we like it or not, those closest to us geographically are also those closest to us politically and economically.
She
went to Berlin quite quickly, but I think to reassure some of our other colleagues that would have been important. Also in terms of the language and where we've gone with this. I know it's very difficult. People use terms hard and soft, Brexit, whatever that means. But we've got a little bit of Brexit. We've got a soggy Brexit and all sorts of different Brexit. But I think that... We're now in a situation whereby we're going down a certain path, whereby people, EU nationals, feel a great deal of uncertainty. That could have been an easy win. Our partners feel that we're pulling away. The language over the weekend was extraordinary. I mean, I have to say, Michael Collins remarks over Gibraltar. He does speak for the government. We're in a space that we didn't need to be in. Now, where you start the space in the immediate aftermath of a referendum is very important. So, again, it's the closest reference we have. After all parties voted for independence, the plan that was set out in our white paper was that the negotiating team would have consisted of, because we accepted it was a big move, as big as this one, that the negotiating team would have consisted of the leaders of other political parties, would have drawn on stakeholders from across society. The first thing we would have done is to go down and reassure our partners elsewhere on these islands, they remained a priority in terms of the relationship. Now, the people might disagree with that approach, and that's their right, but I think that the tone that you set at the very start sets the tone throughout that two-year period. The two-year period will be over and done within no time, and so I just don't think we started off in a great place for it, and that doesn't bode well for going forward.
Okay, and before the point, Douglas, you say that you have to say we're prepared to walk away, but do you accept that if we were to walk away without a deal? I mean, you've actually argued probably not. You don't think that is that damaging. You think WTO would be okay?
If I could press fast, I realise that in politics, when you see the other lot win, it's kind of annoying. And you want to think the worst of them. But I think it's really important that if there is to be conciliation, if people like on my side of the debate are trying to be conciliatory about this, it's at least important to understand and accept and recognise what's actually being done in the real world. Theresa May sent a letter, and the letter that she, the response that she got back was overwhelmingly positive. We were told 2 months ago there was no good will. The letter very clearly shows good will. With the sole exception of the inclusion at the behest of the Spanish government, predictably, of the issue of Gibraltar, everything else in that response could have been written. I was in Berlin last week talking to people at the COP20 conference, and the amount of pragmatism and goodwill, it's clear to me that a deal is going to be done. If Theresa May had said, I must do a deal, whatever, there simply wouldn't be that willingness. Simply because why should if you go to a second-hand car dealer and say, I'm a spare car from your showroom this afternoon or else, you're probably not going to get as good a deal as if you say, well, show me what you've got.
One thing that perhaps, however positive the language may have been, that might worry people in that letter was a suggestion that an FTA by 2019 is actually quite a big task. And yes, they are willing to open talks on trade issues after they've just opened talks in the other areas. It's still quite clear that we're not clear. And the reason that it was clear is because they said there could be transition. Do you think that transition is something that could be politically acceptable in the country?
For all the version, I expect there will be transition arrangements. And anyone familiar with the actual practicalities of import and export will tell you it's already hideously complicated. But I fully expect that when it comes to rules of origin, there will be transitional arrangements. And I think it's significant that Theresa May didn't rule out some aspects of that.
And by that, do you mean we haven't got a deal yet, so there'll be a period where we carry on as we are before we get to a deal? Or do you mean a kind of implementation phase, as they say?
If you manufacture electronic components, and one of those components is manufactured in the UK and the rest of the components are manufactured outside, you need to have a technological infrastructure to allow you to move the goods in their various completed stages of the supply chain. It can be done, but if you look at the history of the British state and IT projects, the idea that everything that needs to be done is going to be done in 24 months is for the birds. But these are practical technological solutions.
So
people weren't voting because they were angry about the rules of origin.
That's a fact on June the 23rd.
I know that. But what I'm trying to ask you is, are there other areas that, politically speaking, going into 2020, Theresa May has to have nailed down? Or could you see, for example, a lengthening of freedom of movement rules remaining as they are?
As I said, quite explicitly, free movement of people will have come to an end, and I chose my words extremely carefully, by, if not before, April 2019. That doesn't mean that free movement of workers need not apply. Oh. And I, you know, having spent 25 years thinking about this in some detail, I'm fairly clear in my mind to a process of logic and elimination as to where we will end up. But, you know, of course,
how would you describe that? Where we'll end up?
I suspect we'll end up with something, and the paper that I've done on this suggests that any company or employer that has a real-time relationship with HMRC through PAYE would be allowed to issue national insurance numbers. Their system for doing so is a mess and cleaning up anyway. And that you'd be able to issue national insurance numbers to hire people from EU member states with one major proviso, and that is you pay them more than £24,000 a year. Why £24,000? Well, you need to preclude the possibility of them claiming any work benefits, and you need to do something about the issue of wage compression. But that threshold can be set or could be reviewed by Parliament every year. It's quite a detailed, complex solution that I think is quite liberal. It avoids the nonsense of having quotas so that IT companies would have to call themselves construction workers to qualify. You would have alongside that a seasonal worker scheme. As I say, people who have been thinking about this for quite some time don't see the complexities that those who don't want this to be happening seem to find.
You think that's the reason people see complexities?
Quite often, yes.
Okay, yeah. Can I do answer that? Just put this to you as you hear, as our Labour person on the panel. Douglas says he's comfortable about freedom of movement of workers. And arguably, that is the system that exists within Europe now, whilst it has always been very easy to come and live in the UK, it has not been quite so easy.
It's very, very different from the States Fair. It's really important that we
let me just explain what I would say the status quo at the moment. If you go to Belgium, for example, it's not as easy as if you come to the UK. And the reason it's not quite so easy is if after 3 months you can't prove either A, that you've got a job, or B, that you've got really quite high levels of personal wealth and income, then you lose access to very, very basic things like electricity. So, unlike in the UK, where it's very easy to come and live, it's not so easy in Belgium. But we didn't enforce the rules that actually existed that really did. So, the Labour government didn't do that. So, why wasn't that? Well, maybe, let me talk about what I think where we need to go in future. There are a number of options out there for how the system should change. I do believe that it should focus on work. We could have strengthened existing rules, but we didn't. Going forward, you could either have an option where people have to have a job offer before they come. You could also, my colleague Liam Byrne has looked at how you might adopt a modified version of the points-based system we have for workers from outside the EU, which would keep freedom of movement for high-skilled workers and for students, which would have a way of setting quotas in low-skill areas, although I think it is always very difficult, I have to say, to work for plan, a very dynamic economy. I think all of those are options. I wanted to come back to something that you talked a bit about Europe and where Europe stands in this. I was also in Berlin the week before last, and a couple of things really struck me. First was that there was a clear sense that Brexit has given the remaining EU 27 countries a strong impetus to address the underlying issues, particularly within the Eurozone, on jobs, growth, unemployment. There seems to be a real determination that that has to be addressed. And secondly, on the issues of security and migration. I really did get a strong sense of that when I was there. But the second thing was, Brexit actually isn't a massive priority for them. Mm-hmm. You know, we're here understandably and rightly obsessing about it, but it is not the thing that's top of their agenda. You know, the world doesn't revolve around us. And when you're doing a negotiation, you have to understand where your colleagues are coming from. Yes, you have to be tough about what you want to see out of it, but you also have to understand the priorities of your partners. And I'm afraid we've got a collective failure to do that at the moment. Okay. Steve, I've got one quick question for you, and I'm going to try and take a couple of questions, and then we'll come back to questions again later.
Yeah.
So it seems very clear to me that, you know, Douglas has got a very well thought out idea about where free movement may end up.
Yeah.
After April 2019, the Labour Party pretty clear now that it has to be reformed, having seen the vote in many of your own heartlands. Your compromise document talks about allowing free movement to continue. I presume that you only mean within Scotland.
Well, actually, no. I mean, our compromise document was for the whole of the UK.
Hold on.
If that was rejected by the rest of the UK, we also set out the powers that we'd require so that we could just have it in Scotland.
Okay, so I suppose the question has to be, there was a referendum, people voted out.
Yeah.
What under your plan do you provide to people to acknowledge that they voted out?
Well, they didn't vote out in Scotland, so, you know, we only stand in Scotland. First of all, on the UK-Belgium issue that you talked about, now, you know, in terms of immigration, that was a problem. The Belgians have taken that policy decision, the UK has taken a different policy decision. That is not something that's the fault of the European institutions, and that's something that was led through the EU referendum. So the point that you start out, the floor sits at Westminster, it doesn't sit in Brussels, and that's important. Our civil movement, and why it's important to us, and why it will continue to be important to us, and why we will continue to fight for it. It goes to the fact that we've got a great deal of immigration. You can have differential immigration systems, as you do in Canada, Australia, and elsewhere. You know about the imagination, and this is where your union is juggling. But Whitehall, which is a poor state, you've got a great deal of blockage, and that's the same for a Labour government, as much as it has been for a Tory government. Some of it is important. It's not just in terms of the craft in it. There are areas such as opportunities for young people. We know there are a lot of young people from Scotland, for instance. I look at France as the biggest employer in my constituency by some distance is the University of St Andrews. Now, it is a competitive market to bring in the brightest and the best from around Europe and elsewhere in the world. A big selling point is freedom of movement. And why would you get somebody who's giving a field and encouraging to come to St Andrews rather than go elsewhere? And freedom of movement has been key to that. People are able to bring their partners. You don't have the same paperwork, and also, critically, you're able to participate with other European universities. And one thing that Douglas talks about is deregulation. Actually, by removing yourself from the European Union, you increase regulation because you're starting up your own framework, and then if you want to negotiate with a European university, you have to cut across boundaries on that. So, I think that's where it's going to be our responsibility to try and fight for as much freedom of movement as we can possibly get. We need immigration really badly, probably more so than any other part of the United Kingdom.
And just culturally on that, is there no kind of anti-immigration feeling within Scotland? I mean, it's human nature, isn't it, to feel anxiety about another group?
I think you start the same debates around immigration, but we don't have the same fiscal pressures as can see. And that can be for a whole number of reasons, especially in Douglas' when he's doing this now, he's outside the party. UKIP has never saved as a deposit in a parliamentary election, Scottish or Westminster in Scotland. You know, they sort of trip along at about 2%, they're pretty irrelevant. To be fair, the leaders of all the political parties in Scotland, including the Conservatives, Labour, even Labour, Liberals, Greens, SNP, have been very strong in terms of talking about immigration as a good thing. I think there's been political leadership from all the parties, and actually, to be fair to my Scottish Labour colleagues, I think they've been let down really badly from the UK colleagues in terms of your monks and all sorts that you had. So immigration is not the same problem. It could be for a range of reasons. It could be we need immigration, but I think to be fair to the leaders of one of the political parties is about leadership on the issue as well.
Douglas, just quickly, would you object to a differential deal for different parts of the United Kingdom?
I think ultimately it's for people in Scotland to decide to stay in Scotland and for people in Oxford to decide to stay in Oxford. Last time I checked, Scotland had a referendum and most people wanted to stay in the United Kingdom. But if there's another one in a few years' time, you know, it's up to Scotland, it's not up to me.
It's about what we owe, it's commitments we've made. It's not about them punishing us and making us pay more. It's things we've signed up to, and I've always believed that if you make a deal and you promise you're going to deliver something, that's what you do, and they will simply be asking us to pay what we owe. I'm sure there'll be a negotiation about that, and maybe it can be phased over time, but I think as a country, if you've committed to budget, you should stick by those commitments.
Can I come to the next question in a minute? I think
can I just say, please don't use the term reparations. It's exactly the wrong tone. A few member states across the channel are our friends, and we want a good relationship with them. We are going to have to come to an arrangement over the terms, financial terms, of our departure. I think it's completely wrong when people rather lazily say it's a divorce and therefore everyone's just arguing about cash and access. It's not that. We need to get on with our neighbours. And that means talking and dealing with them in good faith. If, for example, a road is being built in Spain today, and the bill for that will go to Madrid in 4 years' time, and Madrid will present that bill to Brussels, well, you know, we're a country that honours our obligations and our commitments. We've never defaulted on our bonds, and our word is our bond. Incidentally, the fact we don't have to pay any of that means we've got an incredibly strong hand in our negotiations, but if we want to have people deal with us in good faith, we have got to be prepared to act in good faith. What we will not do, and absolutely not do, is a cash-to-market access deal. Why? George III tried that with the American colonies. It's called mercantilism, and it's a really, really bad idea. Cash-to-access is not going to happen. I don't actually think it needs to happen. I had in my pocket a mobile phone that was designed in California, assembled in China using chips from Japan, and software made in India. We don't actually have a deal with any of those countries, and it's possible to trade them. Trade doesn't happen because of mercantilist politicians bringing in rules and regulations, let alone paying tribute.
Just quickly, I almost want the answer to no, but could you have been a future in which we were still part of the single market?
If Tony Blair had achieved the Lisbon agenda, if he had made good on his promise to roll us on, we would not be leaving the single market. What necessitates us leaving the single market above all else is the fact that actually the single market has moved from being a force for liberalisation that allows us to be competitive to doing to Europe what the Mandarinate did to China in the 14th century, smothering innovation under a blizzard of rules and regulations. That is what ultimately seals the fate of the single market.
Can I just say that Douglas has rightly said that we stick by what we've promised, but he does not represent many of the hardline executives in the government or in the media who will want Britain to refuse to pay anything. And in fact, in UKIP, one of their six tests is paying nothing. So you are not the representative of.
The vote leave message the official campaign message was entirely defensible. We may have pointed out that there will be pressures on public services, but we also made it very clear that actually migration is not only a good thing, it's a prerequisite if you want to have a higher standard of living. And yet, look, I want to say that this is what really gets to our point. People want to think the worst of you. And people want to think
I have a lot of memories of it.
We know from examples elsewhere, and actually it was Michael Gove who said that we could have differential immigration systems across the United Kingdom if the UK voted to leave the European Union. It was on the performance one of Douglas's colleagues on Vote Leave who said that this was an idea that we should look at rolling out. And actually it's something that happens elsewhere in the Commonwealth, for instance, in Australia and in Canada. You have differential immigration systems between the states.
Do you base it on a demand? So, for example, areas that are happy to have immigration, or do you base it on the number of immigrants that are in an area?
Well, I think you suit your immigration policy to that. You know, you can best suit your economy. So, this is something that we have. We need immigration in terms of. Now, I mentioned the university sector earlier on. I'll come back to the other point that you raised. But also food and drink sector, you know, seasonal work is really important where I come from and some of the food and drink products. It's not all about university professors being able to travel to any, you know, this is about different layers of that.
A colleague of Liz's, Chukwuemeka, chairs an all-party group on integration, and one of the ideas they had was that you had a differential immigration system for different regions.
Yeah.
The problem I envisage with it, and you tell me if you think this is true or not, is it's all very well to say Scotland is happy as a country to see more immigration. They were talking about areas that had lower demand on public services, for example, getting a higher quota. And I can't imagine that some of those areas, say, for example, in parts of England, where I suspect the leave rate was very high, would welcome the idea that they would get more immigrants while London would get less, for example.
It's very difficult for me to comment on I'll go back to that point around leadership and actually having an honest debate around immigration. We benefit from immigration. Our economy benefits from immigration. I think there are stats that came out during the EU referendum from LSE that said that if you were to remove every EU national from the UK by magic, you'd have a £20 billion black hole in your economy because of the difference between the taxes they paid and the services that they were using. So I think something, and that's why I've got those products.
Don't take into account the public service costs. And if you put in, take into account public service costs, those figures are more like neutral.
Well, if you think, the fact of the matter was, they use that more. They pay more in taxes than they take away in services. But critically, and this is critical, is the fact that EU nationals, and I mentioned the food and drink sector, also mentioning the energy sector, the university sector, they have to grow our economy because we're able to bring in different skills and expertise. And critically, this is something I benefited from, which is I was able to utilize freedom of movement, work elsewhere in Europe. When I went back home, and this is something that the Irish government has been very big on in terms of growing in their economy, I had skills, expertise, contacts that I wouldn't have had if I hadn't had freedom of movement. So the kind of economy that you want, the kind of society that you want as well. And on the final point, so I can address what the lady said, how we see especially on the, I deliberately didn't mention students, but I think something like that a significant proportion of students from England coming to universities in Scotland, even though they have to pay fees, as you do in Ireland and elsewhere. My point was on the academic staff. Well, yes, it's been for Europeans, yes. I'm afraid they're the rules, because the rules are that English students have to adhere to the rules that are set by the government that's been voted for south of the border. So, yes, they are free for European students, and one of our biggest problems now is filling up these people and being able to keep them. And on the border point, there are two borders. We've already heard about Northern Ireland, and David Davis has said specifically that there should not be a hard border between Northern Ireland and the rest of Ireland. Now, if that applies to Northern Ireland, there's no reason why that shouldn't apply to Scotland as well.
How do you see the Irish border working?
Well, it's been 3 million people in the whole of the island of Ireland since the 1920s, then it's not determined by our EU membership. No one wants a restoration of the border. I went with some officials from the Irish Foreign Ministry
after a conference in Donegal, and they showed me where the border had been. It wouldn't just be impractical, it would be politically intolerable for lots of people. And but, you know, it's perfectly possible to do this. In fact, there's goodwill on both sides. Dublin has made it clear they don't want a return to the border, and London's made it clear they don't want a return to the border. It is possible to be a self-governing country and have close ties with near neighbours and be self-governing and allow the free movement of people across the borders.
Well, you could end up in a situation where London, Leicester, Cambridge, Bristol, okay, we voted Remain, why can't we? You know, I'm Labour because I believe in unions, by which I mean that you pool your resources and you share your risks. That you're better off as an individual when you have the support of others rather than sink or swim. And that is why I get extremely concerned about people calling for different, you know, completely different systems in different parts of the country. But what I think we should do, as powers are returned from Brussels, is to push them out, not just from Westminster, but Edinburgh, which is, you know, Scotland itself is very centralised, and the SNP are holding on to powers which they often don't use. I would like to see devolution to give people more power and control over the things that really matter to them, whether that's jobs, housing, or education. That's not going to happen, I think. There are still very big differences
to join into the
government. No, but I do think I certainly have been working with Conservatives and Liberal Democrats, slightly less the Assembly for various things, and think that we have done on some issues, but we rather agree, whether that's on the rights of EU citizens or other issues. So I do think. I don't believe that party politics is dead. Lots of people say now the only issue to Remain versus Leave. I don't believe that.
I only said that.
But there are ways that you can work with others on the issues that really matter. And there's a lot more common ground than you might think.
Would you have more common ground, for example, with some Liberal Tories and some Lib Dems than you do with Jeremy?
I certainly have more in common with some Liberal Conservatives who would like to see us Remain close partners with Europe, who believe we should make sure EU citizens have the same rights they do now, and crucially, that merger deal is the worst possible deal, not just because of tariffs, because of non-tariff barriers, because of tariff quotas, and the shocks that and uncertainty that would cause. There are a strong group of people from across the political spectrum who are going to stand up for that new deal option, which I believe remains a significant risk.
I would argue, actually, that a fundamental problem in British politics today is that we haven't really had a unity government, but we've got a cartel in politics, and we've had a cartel in politics, which means that the same sort of people, usually who do the same sort of PPE degrees, the same Oxford colleges, becoming MPs and then parachuted into the front bench, with the same views on things, have made so much of politics so indeterminate. There's this orthodoxy that's been in place for 40-something years on our EU membership, an orthodoxy on monetary policy, which I think has been a disaster and a disgrace, an orthodoxy on central reserve banking and the disaster that is proving to be. And I think the real problem that this country faces is that we need a proper opposition. By opposition, I don't mean shouting angrily at Prime Minister's questions. I don't mean taking up phony soundbite positions to make out that you're really unlike them and then going off to the tea rooms to pat each other on the back. I mean genuine public policy alternatives, not just on the question of our EU membership, but on a whole range of areas where a political cartel has basically rigged democracy, denied us choice, and then fix the economy so that my constituents in Clacton lose out through the so-called bedroom tax. Big banks in London get £37 billion worth of bailouts and billions of pounds worth of subsidy known as quantitative easing. If we have an intelligent, dare say, liberal opposition, we may get some change. I would be working on the assumption that it would be an election in 2019. Well, because she's not going to call one quite yet. She's got a working majority on three-line whip issues of 46. We all know that. Those who can count know that. She doesn't need to call an election before then.
I suspect if you did stay very soon after Brexit, it would be a slam dunk. And I'm working on the assumption. I don't know. I'm not sure that people who decide these things know, but it would be my working assumption that there would be an election in the summer, early summer of 2019.
Everything that Theresa May has said so far, she said she wanted immigration was the big message she got from the referendum that was going to be controlled, she wanted out of the ECJ. She said no deal is better than a bad deal. She has actually stuck by what she said. I don't agree with it, but she has. So all of these people who say there's going to be an unknown election, it doesn't matter what she said, I'm not yet convinced. Unless some of the no deal extremists in her party absolutely refuse to let her strike any give or take deal with Europe, that one is a possibility, but she's put everything she said, she's pretty much stuck by it, and I assume that that may be the case.
I think every possible opportunity since the early hours of Friday morning on June the 24th, trying to be conciliatory. And again and again and again and again, I get thrown at me the accusation that somehow a bad moral person who was responsible for all sorts of arguments that I've never made, positions I've never adopted, and lines of thought that have never entered my head. And what I'm going to do is just carry on very patiently, trying to convey the don't leave idea, which is that actually we can make a success of our country, and we can change our country for the better. If the people like me, who have a say over the making of our laws and policies, and I can see it in their jobs because of the voters. And I think that argument can be wrong. I'm a little depressed. If you feel as strongly as I do about the need for high environmental standards, why, for heaven's sake, don't you think you could win the argument amongst the public? For years, people who wanted high environmental standards have channeled their efforts and their energy into buying influence amongst the lobbying community in Brussels. You say, why haven't we got high environmental standards? Perhaps because people who feel that we need higher standards haven't invested the energy in making that argument with the public. And I found this extraordinary. The argument that we need higher environmental standards and an agricultural policy that actually works to preserve the environment rather than just enrich farmers, it's so obvious to me. Now we have to have the self-confidence to make these arguments. If campaign groups like yours were to put that effort and energy into making sure that in 2020 there was such a compelling case in various party manifestos on this, I think you could get that. You don't need to buy people dinner in Brussels to improve environmental standards in this country. And I think it's a stand up, you can win that argument in
2019. Well, let's just say it, Ms. Courtney. The idea that it's somehow the failure of environmental charities who are back to back to call for decent standards in this country as well as Europe. But that is not the reason, and I think, sorry, to be right, patronising to suggest that whether probably said you want better rights here, as I did on maternity and paternity, I was fighting members of your last former party and your former party on these issues.
The government's going to be right, right?
I don't know.
We don't invest in, do we? We've benefited enormously from the environmental legislation. I knew it from my own time in the Scottish government that actually we found more funds in Brussels than we did in Westminster. So when we're pushing renewables for a business perspective, when we're pushing further on the habitat directive or for the world these climate change targets, we were finding firms and allies in Brussels and amongst European partners that we certainly weren't finding. But work, plus business, plus the next five institutions.
The UK government would only go to, going down to government, would only go to 36%. We tried to get you to go further, but we would have thought that goals
and regulations. If British people vote for government that doesn't provide those regulations, isn't that
nice? Well, it is really like a highlight when we talk about regulation, how in a European context, if you're breaking down those barriers, you're going to... And one thing we're saying with, and actually maybe this is because coming from a smaller country, if you like, is actually sharing sovereignty is something we're pretty comfortable with, be it on the environment, be it on climate.
Will we be well on our way to a second referendum?
Well, let's see. I mean, I've been listening to what people talk about whether or not it would be an early election, and I think it should always be prepared to start an election. There's an ongoing campaign. I hope that those involved in Vote Leave, I will say, that's a little bit better. I think that the good points. During our final campaign, I said that let's recognise that the UK could do well outside the European Union. We lost both of them.
Yeah.
But let's recognise that the UK could do well outside the EU, and that's the basis from which we should have a debate. I found myself in a Vote Leave leaflet advocating that the UK should leave the European Union in extraordinary misrepresentation.
If it's over where it currently is, I think that's just doesn't affect. We have an absolute mountain to climb. Let us not forget that at the last election, 2015, meant that we would have to win almost 100 seats to form a majority. Now we are well behind in the polls. So if the election returns tomorrow, it's definitely obvious that we wouldn't win. That is why we have got to take the fight to the Tories, not just on what they're proposing on Brexit, but to consider the underlying issues that people are facing, a decade of stagnating wages. It's virtually impossible for young people to buy a home. That our schools are struggling, our NHS has been crisis. Ultimately, I think sometimes we make politics really complicated, and it's not. It's simple. People want the same things. A decent job that pays a good wage, a home to call their own, good schools, and a care system that helps them get better or get back on their feet when they need it. That's what we have to focus on, a unifying message about the future that everyone can feel proud of, not just a big focus on leaving the main. And if you all fight in that direction, can you do it behind the leadership? But things will have to change, as Jeremy and other members of the Shadow Cabinet have said. We've got to turn the polls round, and that's what I want to see us all focusing on, from right from the top of the party, right through to the grassroots. All right, thank you. Douglas?
I think Liz speaks with great passion and meaning, but I wonder if perhaps that actually one of the fundamental changes in politics is that people don't want to feel that politics is us on this stage doing stuff for them. I think it's the nature of the relationship between the governed and the governing that is now changing. It's a bit like, well, the Reformation and the printing press, but happening in a period of 10 years rather than a couple of centuries. I think what is going to look increasingly retro is the idea that, you know, if you vote for me, I will promise to fix every classroom and the curriculum and the economy. People just realise that actually that this is why it's a triumph for real liberals. Liberal coming from the Latin word liber, free. Recognition that actually the world is full of self-organising systems, that order is self-emergent. The idea of these politicians claiming that if we vote for them, they can fix it, is a deceit. and I think people are losing faith in people who peddle that essential perception. And this is ultimately why politics is going into such an exciting and exhilarating place. It's exhilarating if, like me, you think that the days when small groups of people should try to order our lives for us, whether it's in Brussels or Westminster or London or Chelmsford Town Hall, if you think those days are coming to an end, I think it's really going to be rather beautiful.
Moderate progressive Labour Party that doesn't seek to do things for people but with them, that spreads power and gives people power over their own lives, but has got there by having some honesty and realism about the challenges ahead, and above all, tries to bring the country together, not seek to divide people. Stephen?
I think we'll be independent, and I think that will. That will be, and good things for our southern neighbours to be rethinking their relationships with us in a positive way, but also their European neighbours, and trying to get close to them again.
I think in 2021, I'm not a fair for an ODE. And I think there are some long-term gardeners questions on having more time to take shrubbery back. I suspect that there will be a sense of possibility. This idea that actually, too many areas of public policy, we've been impoverished by the idea that ministers need permission from others and can come back and give us excuses, often bogus, that Brussels won't let them do stuff, and actually we can insist that we do want change. And I think there'll be this tremendous sense that actually public policy can be remade in the interest of the public. I think we'll also have a more mature discussion. Instead of angry headlines to coincide with party conference season about immigration, we'll realise that actually interdependence is a good thing, and we need to encourage more of it, but it is not exclusive to the idea that you cannot at the same time have political independence. The Dutch Republic had both for some time. The interdependence they enjoyed was a prerequisite of in their independence. The Venetians had it, and actually, that would be an exception. It's important for every country in Europe to have that combination of independence and interdependence. And I think we will all be happy for it.